If Professor Sengupta has raised your expectations too high, don't be prepared for an anticlimax. I would like to first of all thank Professor Balram Singh and Professor Sengupta for organizing this conference and giving me an opportunity to come and share my thoughts. As we have seen in the papers and presentations so far, the word consciousness has come so often and being expressed in so many different ways. And I often have wondered why there are so many different perspectives or ideas on any given subject, such as the one that we are discussing now. And it appears to me that possibly these different perceptions occur either due to the different definitions we have for the same term, or the different worldview we bring to it, or the different fields of study, each with its own focus. And I think all of these are probably responsible why the study of consciousness is evoked so many different ideas and so many different approaches. Because we may use the same word, but it may not necessarily evoke the same ideas in our mind. The understanding of consciousness is also contingent, as I said, upon the worldview of a person. How we understand consciousness is dependent on how we perceive the objects that we are conscious of. And in a generic sense, what we are conscious of is the world, the inner and outer. And therefore, questions arise, what is the nature of this world of which we are conscious? What is the meaning of reality? And what does it mean to say that the world that we see is real? Is there anything real beyond this world? What is the nature of time? Answers to these questions shape and influence our understanding of consciousness. Furthermore, each field of study, and we have had presentations from many different fields since yesterday, each has its own special focus. So a specific aspect of consciousness gets more attention than others. I shall attempt in this brief paper to describe my understanding of consciousness based on what little I have understood from the study of Vedanta. I shall try to show how the worldview which holds consciousness as the only reality is able to explain the present human predicament and show the way to overcome it. Far from being a theoretical construct or a matter of merely religious belief, the worldview presented in Vedanta offers a rational way to understand our present experience and an attainable goal through proven methods that can be verified by anyone, anywhere, and at any time. Vedanta, the word of course has been used several times in this conference, literally meaning the essence of the Vedas, technically refers to the philosophical portion of the Vedas called the Upanishads. But the word can equally be used to refer to a philosophical or theological foundation of Hinduism. So I speak clearly from my perspective as a Hindu monk, and my views are based on, as I said, the study and practice of Vedanta, especially in the insights derived from the life and works of Swami Vivekananda and his teacher, Sri Ramakrishna. I think it is helpful to begin by distinguishing between consciousness itself and consciousness of objects. More often than not, the word consciousness is used in relation to an object as being conscious of something. It appears as if the presence of consciousness can be confirmed only in relation to something else, something other than itself. This is not unlike confirming the presence of light through the objects that it illumines because we don't really see the light itself. While we become aware of the world around us and within us through consciousness, how do we become aware of consciousness itself? Can consciousness become the object of consciousness? Can it become the object of perception? According to Vedanta, it cannot. Vedanta views consciousness as always being the subject, never an object. It is possible to say that consciousness is in reality always self-consciousness. For instance, any of the statements that we make in life, for instance, now if I say that is a table, this is a chair, to be really accurate about the statement, I should be saying, I am conscious that that is a chair, or I am conscious that that's a table. But then we would have to append every sentence we say, I am conscious of this, I am conscious of that. And since we know that we can only talk about or think about things we are conscious of, we don't really add that statement all the time. So essentially, consciousness is always, from Vedantic perspective, it's always self-consciousness. It's only our own consciousness that we can directly experience. There's a word in Sanskrit called aparokshanubhuti, that I can directly experience only my own consciousness. About consciousness of something other than me, it can at best be inferred, but there is really no guarantee. If there is some, for instance now, we kind of assume that, well, every human being is conscious, but your consciousness is not a matter of direct experience for me. I am aware of only my own consciousness. If someone were to manufacture a robot or a computer which is just human-like in every way and which moves about, I might think it's some another human being has entered the room, and I might say that that's a conscious person, because I'm not able to get inside the other person to know what that person is experiencing or what that person is aware of. So because consciousness usually gets mixed up with the objects of the world, consciousness unrelated to anything else is sometimes called pure consciousness. In Sanskrit, the word is Shuddha Chaitanya. In a manner of saying, when associated with the objects of the world, the consciousness kind of becomes impure or contaminated. That's when we have the term, in Vedantic worldview, consciousness can stand by itself. It doesn't have to be necessarily associated with anything. Now, as I made clear in the beginning, and I would like to affirm it once again, that the statements that I make is from a worldview that Vedanta presents. That I don't intend to mean that that's something which is universal or which has got to be accepted by people looking at the subject from a different paradigm or a different worldview. So, but what I'm presenting to you is a Vedantic worldview and how Vedanta views consciousness and everything. The next question would be, how is consciousness related to an individual? How does it fit into the personality structure of a human being? Vedanta views human personality as trichotomous. The visible part of our personality is clearly the physical, the body. Beyond the body, there is the invisible part, which comprises the mind, the intellect, and the ego, the seat of our feelings, ideas, hopes, memories, and the eye sense. Together, this invisible part of our personality is sometimes called the inner instrument, antarkarana, a word that was again referred to in earlier papers. It is with the help of this inner instrument that we experience the world and try to make sense of it. Now, those that see consciousness as a byproduct of the brain do not need to posit a third aspect of human personality. For them, the personality structure is dichotomous and essentially material. Vedanta does not, however, perceive consciousness as an evolutionary product, but as an entity in its own right. Vedanta views it as the only non-material entity in the human personality. Vedanta thinkers consider that the body, as well as the mind, intellect, and ego, are material. being products of matter, they have to obey the laws of matter. Thus for Vedanta, the human personality becomes trichotomous, comprising the body, the visible material part, the inner instrument, the invisible material part, and consciousness. And here I think Vedanta parts ways with the purely materialistic view, which denies the existence, sometimes even the possibility of existence, of a non-material entity. Furthermore, Vedanta views consciousness as the primary identity of a person. The body and mind are seen as covers over consciousness. It is these covers, in Sanskrit the word often used is kosha, it is these covers which clothe consciousness and give it a material identity. What is perceived is the body. What is sensed is the inner instrument. And the perception and the sensation become possible due to consciousness. But they are different from consciousness. Going back to the analogy of light, the body, the mind, the intellect, the ego are the objects illumined by the light of consciousness. But the real I, the real me, is that light itself. This self-understanding has revolutionary consequences. Being non-material, consciousness is not bound by the laws of matter. It is free from the hold of time and space. Being free from the constraints of time, consciousness is without beginning and without end. Being free from the constraints of space, consciousness is without boundaries, which makes it non-dual. Any finite, limited entity will definitely have some boundary. In the language of Vedanta, consciousness stands by itself, one without a second. Ekam eva advitiyam, as it is said in the Upanishads. Since this is the true identity of every person, we cannot really even speak of it as it. It is really me, the real me. Now, although this may sound very audacious and ludicrous to someone with a different worldview, what this really means is that I am worthless and I am deathless. I am free from any imperfection and change. Birth and death belong to the body, which is only a cover. Imperfection belongs only to the body and the inner instrument, which are again only covers. It is obvious, therefore, why we cannot perceive consciousness in the normal sense of the term. Because we are consciousness, pure consciousness ourselves. The subject can never become the object of its own perception. We can perceive objects only when the light of consciousness shines upon them, and each one of us is that light. Now, of course, the problem is that our present experience is radically different. Not only do we not see ourselves as we really are, but we see ourselves as almost the opposite of it. Instead of seeing ourselves as birthless and deathless, we clearly see the span of our lives as sandwiched between birth and death. Far from seeing ourselves as changeless, we continually experience change physically, mentally, and emotionally. We see changes occurring inside us, and we see changes occurring outside us. The infinitude and perfection associated with consciousness are not a part of our present self-identity. On the contrary, we see ourselves as limited, imperfect, mortal beings. Sometimes the word used in the Upanishads and some of the Vedantic texts is jantu, like insects, mortal insects. Using Vedanta's categories, it is possible to say that somehow we seem to have become identified with our covers. Going back to the analogy of the light again, the problem is that the light has forgotten that it is light. It has begun to see itself as the object that it illumines. This self-forgetfulness produces distortions, making things appear other than what they truly are. The body, the mind, the intellect, and the ego, all material entities, suddenly begin to appear conscious. Theirs is a borrowed consciousness, but we begin to see them as if it belongs to them. So in a Vedantic perspective, therefore, conscious body, they would say that that consciousness doesn't belong to the body. It's the innate consciousness within, which is kind of percolating, getting reflected or just getting manifested through the body, but it doesn't belong to the body. Exactly in the same way, our mind, our intellect, our ego, all these are not conscious in themselves. It's all borrowed consciousness. We also begin to see consciousness which is really boundless as acquiring a boundary defined by a body. The inner instrument, you might have seen, some of you may have read that little book, Jonathan Livingston Seagull by Richard Bach. And in that he says about who is a seagull? Is a seagull the span of a seagull from a wingtip to wingtip? So again, how much space do we occupy in this world? And of course, that space is clearly defined by our body. And that's because somehow our consciousness, which is in reality infinite, has limited itself, has kind of the boundary of that consciousness seemed to have been defined by the boundary of my own physical body. The inner instrument defines the boundary of the world that we perceive and the world that we can conceive of. The world, quote unquote, the world in which we find ourselves is dependent on three prime factors: space, time, and causality. In Sanskrit, they are called desha. Space is desha, time is kala, and causality is nimitta. Desha, kala, nimitta. Consciousness filtered through the layers of time, space, and causality appears as the material world. I would like to say a few words about all of these three: time, space, and causality or causation. The mind through which we operate in this world and we try to understand this world is programmed, kind of conditioned, into always thinking in terms of time, space, and causation. And so it's very difficult, almost impossible for mind to conceive of something that transcends time, or that is not somehow located in space, or that is somehow free from the law of causation. So all of our questions that we may have, even kind of questions that are asked in the religious field, even the question like when did the world begin, even the question when did the world begin, kind of assumes time is a kind of some kind of an infinite entity, because it means that time existed at the time of beginning of this creation for me to be able to ask when it began. But if time itself is a product of creation, if time itself began at some point, then when it began really doesn't make sense. Or even how or where, but even when we say, from where did this world come? Now this question, in fact, well, let me put it this way. Every question is based on some assumptions. And so long as those assumptions themselves are not questioned, one can try to find an answer to it. But it's also possible to question the assumptions themselves. So when we ask a question like, from where did this world come, we're already assuming that something has to come out of something else, or that every effect must have a cause. Now all of these assumptions are fine, and if the person to whom that question is posed accepts those assumptions, then it's the burden of that person to answer that question. But it's also possible to question the assumptions themselves. About time, one of the papers yesterday quoted, I forget the quote, but it was something like, just time doesn't move, but it, time just remains still. There is a Sanskrit text, I believe it's either 14th or 15th century, written by Bhartrahari, in which in fact a very similar idea comes. He says, Kalo na yata, vayameva yata. Time doesn't move, it is we who move. Well, it's pretty much like a relative motion. We somehow think that we are stationary, and so time seems to be passing. But really, it's time which is stationary, and we are moving. Swami Vivekananda once said, that's an amazing quote, he said, time is but the method of our thinking. We are the eternal present tense. So one of the ways in which this consciousness, which has got limited to this body-mind entity, the consequences are, first of all, the division of time into past, present and future. If we look at these terms, past, present and future, they are just mental constructs, because the present moment, as I was saying, you only have the present moment to deal with. That moment which is not yet come, a future moment, the very next moment becomes the present moment, and a moment later has become a past moment. So you cannot really catch hold of this past and present and future. But if we see our own lives, how much of our lives are just kind of caught into the past and the future. The past makes its presence felt in our life through in the form of memories, pleasant memories, painful memories, but we are still held down by the past. The future makes its appearance in our lives in the form of anxiety about the future or uncertainty about the future. And so even while we really have no choice, we are really living in the present moment. I cannot live yesterday. Yesterday is already gone. I cannot live tomorrow because tomorrow is not yet come. I can really live only today. But even when I'm living today, we have to look at the way our mind functions and ask, how much of me is really in the now? How much of me is thinking about things that have gone by? How much of me is thinking about things that are yet to come? And we shouldn't be too surprised if we find that most of our lives really are spent either remembering the past or being anxious about the future, which really means that very little life is actually lived. We exist, but we probably don't live. By that I mean, if we look back at our own lives, no matter what age group we belong to, it might look like our lives have moved quite fast. If you look back, say, last 20, 30 years of our lives, mostly our experience would be time has passed very fast. What's interesting is, while the past 10 or 20 years may have seemed to have gone by so quickly, when we think about the 10 or 20 years ahead of us, they seem to be like a long time ahead. But if my past 20 years have gone by so fast, there is no reason why the next 20 years should take a long time. The reason, according to Vedantic thinkers, of why time may seem to go fast is that it has not been lived consciously. That so consciousness, here is a different way that Vedanta looks at the whole the concept of what does it mean to live in a conscious way. And if we live in a conscious way, we may find that time, we may be able to see different dimension or different meaning into time. But whenever we see that life has moved much faster, it probably means a lot of it was we were not really conscious. Even if we go by our daily routine, how many of the things that we do daily on a daily basis are we even conscious of? Some of the things have become very mechanical. things that we do, get up in the morning, brush our teeth, take a shower, we don't think like that needs a lot of conscious activity. We might think, well, while I'm taking a shower, I can think about the things that I have to do. So my taking a shower or brushing the teeth, it doesn't become a conscious activity because I use it to plan my day for the future, plan my day that day. And then, but if my mind has gotten used to doing things mechanically, then when I'm actually doing those activities which I planned while taking my shower, that time I would be thinking of what I'm going to do next. So our lives then pretty much become like the lives of an automaton. It's not a conscious living. And that is one of the difficulties that occurs. That is how time plays upon us. So that's, and that is the reason why consciousness gets is not able to break free from the hold of time. Similarly, the hold of space. Space is again the doubt that I had in the first paper this morning was about reality. The space, normally when most of the material sciences that deal with things, they essentially, it's the only the waking reality that seems to be the focus of our attention. But our dream experience is as much our experience as the waking experience. And so the question that can arise is, where is the space that we see in our dream located? So we may have to revise our understanding of even space. Again, I just mentioned this just to show that the waking space is not the only space that's available to us. So in Vedanta, they often a lot of discussion has gone into analyzing what are considered basically the three states. The state of waking, in which we all are, hopefully, many of us. And then there is a state when we go to sleep, and then we all dream for a long time. I used to think when I was young that I don't dream. And then until someone corrected me and said, no, everyone dreams, you just don't remember your dreams, that's all. In any case, so there is this second experience that we all have of dreams. And then we also know that every night there is a small, at least for a short length of time, we all pass into a really deep sleep when we don't even dream. And so that is in Sanskrit, that is called sushupti, a dreamless sleep. So these are essentially three distinguishable experiences that we pass through in a 24-hour cycle. In Vedanta has often posed questions about the experience that we have in each of these three states. The question of time again comes up. How is dream time? Is the dream time related to the waking time? We may have slept for 6 or 7 or 8 hours, and within that time we may have had several dreams, but in that dream, if I have been, say, dreaming for an hour, what I see in my dream, the world that I encounter in my dream, is not necessarily for just 1 hour. In that dream, perhaps my dream has lasted, the dream world of my dream existence could have been for 10 or 20 years. Although in the waking time, that's been just 1 hour. But just because 10 years have passed in my one dream, they don't seem to go any faster than the time that seems to go here. Then there are three kinds of dreams. Waking dream, dream dream, deep sleep dream. In the Chandogya Upanishad, tatra traya svapnaha, there are three kinds of dreams. Now, it all boils down to definition. How is the word swapna or dream defined? And the way it gets defined in Vedanta is any perception of other than what is real or any false perception is a dream. And so Since in the Vedantic worldview, consciousness is the only reality, only when consciousness is, we are truly awake. Only then we are really the Buddha. Until that time, perception of anything other than consciousness is really a distortion of reality, and therefore it's a dream. So, consciousness in these three states remains unchanged, really. Consciousness is never changes, but by tainted by association, so to speak, it's possible to speak about consciousness in the waking state, consciousness in the dream state, and consciousness in the deep sleep state. So, the levels of consciousness that one can speak of is only in a relative sense, because in itself, consciousness does not change. Vedanta also speaks about the possibility of considering levels of reality. For instance, now, the classical, let me give you a classical example which many of you may be familiar with already. The classical example is of a coiled rope in a room which is not sufficiently lighted, being mistaken for a snake. And so you enter a room and there is this rope and you think it's a snake and you are afraid or you cry out, and then you switch on the light and then you find, oh no, it's just a rope. And the question that is asked is, what is the status of reality of the snake that is perceived? Is the snake real or not real? Was the snake there or not there? Well, all that we can say is that, well, as long as I saw the snake, it was there. I mean, I saw a snake, which is why I was afraid. If I had seen the rope, I wouldn't have been afraid. On the other hand, if the snake was really there, the snake should have been there when I switched on the light. So obviously, the reality of the rope was always a rope, even when it was darkness and there was light. But somehow the rope was mistaken for a snake. So the reality of a snake seems to belong to a different level than the reality of the rope. And so the Sanskrit, the typical terms for this is that the snake is considered pratibhasika satta. The rope here would be the vyavaharika satta. Which I find it convenient to translate the terms as the snake as an apparent reality and the rope as a relative reality. And why do I say relative reality? Again, partly because the rope itself disappears when I fall asleep. The rope will disappear when I get into samadhi, for instance. And so the third level of reality that Vedanta speaks about is called Paramarthika Satta, means absolute reality. That brings us to how Vedanta views reality. There's one kind of assumption made in Vedanta, which is never really proved. And that is, in Sanskrit, they say Satyam equals Nityam, which means that if something is real, it has got to be eternal. There is no such thing, according in the Vedantic use of the terms, there is no such thing as a temporary reality. Because if it is temporary real, we don't really take it all that seriously. We don't take all of our dreams seriously. Because, well, it's not real. Because the dream didn't exist before I fell asleep. And the dream doesn't exist after I wake up. It seemed to have only an intermediate existence. There is a well-known Vedantic text which says that Adavante chayan nasti madhyakale itattatha. That means that which didn't exist in the beginning and didn't exist in the end probably didn't exist in the middle as well. And dreams are like that. The dream world which we inhabit when we are dreaming, it didn't exist before I fell asleep. It doesn't exist when I wake up, and therefore we say the dreams are not real. What we don't always have the courage to say, even if sometimes we may think about it, is the same thing holds true to this world as well. This world didn't exist when I was asleep, and when I wake up, the world comes, and when I when I fall asleep, again, the world disappears. So just as the dream disappears when I wake up, the world disappears when I fall asleep. So really, there isn't any special reason why this world should be considered more real than the dream. But that's not the main focus of what I'm saying. I just wanted to show you the kind of questioning that has gone on in Vedantic thinking. So dreams, therefore, so I mentioned dreams to show that what doesn't have a lasting presence, we don't honor that entity by calling it real. And so therefore, in Vedanta, reality always is equated with eternality. And from that perspective, therefore, they consider that consciousness is the only unchanging entity which always is. It has no beginning and no end. Everything else, the body, the mind, they are changeable, they are begin at one point, they end at one point, therefore they cannot be real. I'm just to just conclude by just one observation. Oftentimes in material sciences, we give the reason, why is something real? Why is this bottle of water real? Because I see it, because I can feel it. Interestingly, in Vedantic thinking, in Shankaracharya's commentaries, he gives the same reason to show it's not real. Why is this not real? Because I see it, because I feel it. The idea is that katham drishyatvat mithya, why? Because I'm able to experience it. The idea is that the subject, because the reality seen as non-dual, that there is only the eternal subject, and therefore anything which can be objectified, anything which is a matter of my perception through the senses and the mind cannot be real because it's an object. And applying that to everything, if I can see my body, it can't be real, it's an object of my perception. Anything that is an object of my perception cannot have a lasting reality because the subject alone is true. So this is just some of the ideas that I wanted to present before you to briefly sum up what I have said. In Vedantic thinking, consciousness is one, non-dual, unchangeable. Consciousness is the eternal subject. It can never be objectified. And it is the limiting of consciousness, the apparent limiting of the consciousness is or gives rise to what we say is this material universe. So matter and consciousness are not two independent entities. That what exists is one. If I see that one existence as consciousness, matter would disappear. If I see everything as matter, consciousness would disappear. You cannot be conscious of the two at the same moment, because they are opposed to each other, just as light and darkness. If there is light, then there cannot be simultaneously darkness at the same time, same place. In fact, there is a saying in Sanskrit, and I think it's got an equivalent a Tamil in Thiruvalluvar also in the, has said that. I forget the original Sanskrit right now. The idea is, suppose you have a wooden elephant, a toy made of wood, in the shape of an elephant. And what this verse says is, if you see an elephant, then you cannot simultaneously see the wood. And if you see the wood, then you are not seeing an elephant. So you really can't be seeing both at the same time. Okay, so this is not a very well-organized presentation, but I just wanted to share with you a Vedantic, some of the ideas regarding consciousness that come in Vedantic thinking. Now feel free to share your ideas.
The mind plays a very important role in perception. And perception plays a very integral part in reality. And if we can falsify the perceptions, then we can falsify this whole concept of reality. And I want to know what that falsification of perception have a role to play with your consciousness. That's one question. The next one is that...
No, but please make it a little bit simpler. I don't understand your question.
Perception. If we perceive the rope to be the snake, then to us that snake is a real experience and we would have the fear and all those things. But in actuality, it is not a snake. The same way we can perceive a lot of things in this universe in a very different manner. And therefore, in our internal mechanism, we can falsify images and visions and therefore would have some stature in our reality.
And it's already happening.
So my question to you is, how do these perceptions create a reality and what does that connection has with your consciousness?
Well, perceptions don't create reality. Reality cannot be created. It is this, it's the, what we are perceiving is not what it is truly is. We are seeing reality in a distorted way. We are not creating any reality. So, if things, it's like this, how Vedantic thinkers look at it this way. Now, I see this bottle of water as real. That doesn't mean that, when I say that it's not, this is different from consciousness, which doesn't mean, is there anything in my hand at all? Does it have any reality at all? So, one way of looking at it is, when I say that this is a bottle. Now in this statement can be, say, broken into two smaller statements. That this is something, and that something is bottle. Now I think that first part, this is, that's a true statement. There is something here. But the second part, that something is a bottle, that according to Vedanta wouldn't be a right statement. There's a Vedantic text called Drik Drishya Viveka, which says that each and every entity in this world has five characteristics. And then it begins by saying, I'm just paraphrasing it, Sat, Chit, Ananda, Satyam, Priyam, Bhati, that is the thing it comes. Sat, Chit, Ananda, and Nama, and Rupa. So, existence, consciousness, and bliss or infinitude, and name and form. So everything that is perceived as these five characteristics. But the first three characteristics belong to reality. The last two, name and form, belong to the material world. And it's the name and form that cover the reality. So in a sense, it's possible to say, What I'm holding and whatever it is that is holding it, everything is just reality, just pure consciousness. But that consciousness now is covered by the name and form, and therefore I'm not able to see it. If I can strip this bottle of its name and strip this bottle of its form, I would see nothing but pure consciousness here. So, and we are just surrounded by millions and billions of names and forms. And that's why I'm not creating any reality, but the reality is really getting hidden by these names and forms. That's how Vedanta sees.
My second question is that we have heard about altered states of consciousness. How do altered states of consciousness, or being in an altered state of consciousness, what does that have in the perception and the knowing process in this reality?
Well, all perception occurs to the equipment that we have. It's either the mind, and then of course the physiological part is the brain. And depending on whatever changes that occur in either of these, what we see would be different. So when we say altered states of consciousness, what we really mean is seeing something which the majority is not seeing. Right?
No, well, many times the altered state is in a meditative state, in a state where you're not as we are.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. So majority is not seeing it. So it's something that is done in a specified situation. So again, what all perception occurs through the mind and through so either the physiological changes or mental changes would alter what we see. And of course, in fact, recently with this, the Dalai Lama coming at MIT, etc., the Mind Body Institute, they have been doing a lot of research on when they have put all these measurements for the monks, the Tibetan monks meditating, and what are exactly the changes occurring in the brain and so on. So these are the different states that occur.
There is a one word, satyam, asatyam, and there is an intermediary word, mithya.
Yeah.
Mithya is the one described, the painter, what we are talking about now.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Thank you, Swami. That was a wonderful talk on time, space, and causality. And it makes me think of the chapter that I love by Swami Vivekananda and Freedom. And myself, I have been experimenting with Vipassana, in which I, with teachers from Sharon Salzberg and Joseph Goldstein, being able to name in my meditation, oh, this is doubt, this is judgment, this is fear, this is anxiety. And when I'm off the pillow in my life, when I'm lucky, I can judge, oh, this is fear, this is doubt, this is judgment. And when I do that, it falls away. And then I can be listening to, I hope, intuition. Maybe this is what I should do. Maybe I shouldn't be caught into this. Only because of what Swami Vivekananda spoke about freedom, it is something about that chapter that just drew me. If I can only be free of time, space, and causality, then I can only be. However, can you speak about how hard it is to do that? Because there are sometimes days and weeks that I go by that I'm caught in a dream. And then because of maybe something happening, I'm like, oh, this is my old me. This is what I don't want to be, or this is what a friend will wake me up, or I will wake me up because whatever. But it's so hard to break free of that time, space, causality. And yet the moments that I have done it, then I can see why the Buddha could really help those that needed to be helped.
That's true. I think it's just we have become victims of our own repeated actions. So we have thought about something in one way for a long time. We have done things in one way for a long time. And so it's just the momentum of our past thinking, past actions, which drag us. And then when we try to do a thing, something differently, it's always difficult. But that's, well, it is difficult. I completely agree. Even, those who have practiced serious meditation find that there are times when time can completely come to a stop for you at that moment. And even the notion of space gets completely revolutionized in one's mind. And oftentimes, sometimes when meditators meditate on the object of their meditation in the heart. Now, of course, what kind of heart are we speaking about? The physiological heart really doesn't seem to be, there isn't enough place for anything there to be. That's, can't put the Lord in there. But we also know there's such a thing as a psychological heart, or a heart as a seat of emotions. So there is this emotional heart. But then, in addition to that, many of the Vedanta thinkers and practitioners have said there is such a thing as a spiritual heart. So when we are asked to meditate in the heart, it's not in the physiological heart, not heart as a seat of emotions, but actually a heart center. So the yogis have mapped on along the spinal column 6 centers of consciousness. And as our consciousness rises along that, and of course it gets through, symbolically, we have the word like Kundalini, etc. have become very popular, but essentially it's the activating the different centers of consciousness by which we apparently, the different levels of consciousness become accessible to us. For instance, now therefore, those who have begun, say, as an example, begun to meditate in the heart, in the beginning, when one tries to meditate, when you close your eyes, it's just darkness. But then, as one progresses, one finds, now there is light there. More than light, one first of all discovers a huge space. Physiologically, this doesn't seem to be a big space at all. But in deep meditation, many practitioners have discovered that the space here, Chidakasha, the space of consciousness, Chit, it's huge. I mean, what to speak of one, all the galaxies can fit in here. And then it seems like, oh, it seems reasonable to think of the Lord here, because it's not simply a space so big. So our ideas of time, our ideas of space can get revolutionized. And sure, it's difficult. There's no doubt. It's much easier to let go of some of our material possessions, but to let go of our way of thinking, to let go of our way of understanding the world, it's tough. There is a lot of inner resistance. But one thing is this. I mean, I can clearly understand that, and that is, all of us have grown up in a certain worldview, a certain paradigm of understanding ourselves, understanding the world around us. And so, when we are presented with something which is very different from the kind of paradigm to which we are accustomed to, it's frightening. It's frightening because it means that all the relationships, all the mental constructs that I have about the world, about myself, somehow now have to go and I have to fit it all into this new structure. And that's why it's difficult to make that change. Which is why, again, I think we cannot, I personally believe that while we, all this study of comparative religion, comparative theology, it's very helpful. But I think what really creates problems is to begin with the assumption that the categories in one paradigm or one worldview will have an exact equivalent in some other paradigm or other worldview. I don't think it is. I think each the value and authenticity of a particular worldview has to be judged within its own structure, within its own category. The moment we try to connect the two, we run into difficulty. I mean, in the earlier this morning, we were speaking about Shunya and the other things, which is an interesting as a form of discussion. But I would not, for instance, the word Shunya has a very specific meaning in Buddhist theology. And to kind of imagine that it would have an exact equivalent in some different frames of reference, I don't think it's possible.
First, again, thank you for the enlightening discussion and the clarification of the nature of reality as that which is permanent versus the ephemeral world, phenomenal world we're accustomed to. You use the phrase, that which is changing this way, we cannot honor it by calling it reality. It seems to me that, and that's a very beautiful way of expressing it, and yet we need to distinguish, it seems to me, between the recognition of the ultimate nature of reality on the one hand, and the recognition that, like it or not, we are condemned to live for a certain period of time in this world of ephemeral reality, in the phenomenal world. And as Lord Krishna first says in the Gita, we need to act, we need to discharge the responsibilities and so on. So I was wondering whether, while we are stressing the nature, ultimate nature of reality, as a backdrop in which we have to conduct our lives, it is important not to trivialize, as it were, this changing reality, which also plays a role for a period of time in history, in society, in individuals' lives, and so on. And sometimes I have felt that in our tradition, we have overemphasized the ultimate nature of reality to the point occasionally of almost trivializing or not giving sufficient recognition to that to which we are condemned, as it were, for a period of time. I wonder what you would say.
Well, I would partly agree with what you are saying. Where I disagree is, first of all, the idea that we are condemned to stay. I disagree with that. I don't think we are condemned to stay here. I think we can get out of it right now, this moment, if we want to. We are here not because anybody has condemned us to be here, and I think if we really want to get out of it, the Vedantic idea is we can get out of it now. Vivekananda wrote a poem in which he said, one place, "Thine only is the hand that holds the rope that drags thee on. Nobody is forcing us to hold on to this this limited time, this past, present, future, and this tensions and worries. And I don't believe that we are here because we want to be here. If we want to get out of it, we can. It's not easy, of course. I mean, it's not easy. I'm not saying it's easy. But to think that after a time we'll automatically go, we won't. That's the whole idea about the samsara chakra. That we are apparently in a circle, and a circle has no beginning and no end. And so we are not going to get out of it unless we want to get out of it. And nobody has put us in here. We are just here because we fell asleep and we need to wake up. So, and about trivializing, I can understand I appreciate the purpose why you're saying that. But I think it's also good to see that, and this is going to sound very, very bad, that it is trivial. I say that because, in fact, in a lot of these Vedantic commentaries, what is very interesting is that they have not much bothered about the status of the world at all. They are more worried about the status of the self. How is the jiva related with the paramatma? So the main focus is, how is this related? Is this one? Is it different? Is it part? Is it, and so on. And then we might say, why are we, although the popular Vedantic, there's a verse which says, Brahma Satyam Jagat Mithya, the Brahman is real and the world is unreal, but it really doesn't occur in any Vedic text or anything. That's just a very popular formulation. And the reason why Vedantic thinkers haven't much bothered about the world, because frankly, the reality or unreality of the world cannot be proved. I mean, you can argue about it through the example of a dream and all that. So they say the word used in Sanskrit, tuccha. Tuccha really means not even worth spending time on. And so in that sense, it's pretty trivial. But I understand the what makes you say that we shouldn't trivialize it, because people, and it's for a good reason, people who can talk about these high transcendent things and yet do nothing at all to really rise above this, the present state of existence. And in that sense, therefore, trivializing can appear very bad. But philosophically, the Vedantic thinkers would say, well, it is tuccha, it is trivial. That's what I say.
Swamiji?
Well, first of all, a great lecture, but I just want to look at the whole problem from a slightly different perspective. You spoke of the tripartite world, right? And
the world.
Tripartite view of three worlds, if you will.
Go ahead, I don't know. I suppose the three states of the
three states. Or of course the Vedic view, the three worlds. Or the idea that, let's go back to a scientific formulation. You have the body, you have the activity in the brain, and then you have the world of ideas. And from a practical point of view, the very fact that this world of ideas is so effective, even though it's an abstraction, it's a very small abstraction. You know, you have our body, and our body has all the impressions coming in, then the firings of the neurons inside the brain, and those firings of the neurons are somehow combined together to create these ideas. And these ideas, in some mysterious way, are so effective in descriptions of the world of Nama Rupa, right? Of the world of things. And so from a practical point of view, even if one were to look at it from an aesthetic perspective, isn't it astonishing? Isn't it a matter of beauty? Let's say we are interested in beauty for the sake of beauty. Isn't it a matter of beauty and of the most wonderment that these ideas are able to describe the world of names and things so well? So what's the mystery behind it? And rather than speak of the ultimate reality, can we then sort of limit ourselves and not for solution of any eternal problems, but just for enjoyment of this mystery, ask, well, how does this happen? Why do ideas work? And can our way of unraveling of this world of Nama and Rupa provide us enlightenment? Now, of course, in the Gita, for example, Krishna tells Arjuna that in order to understand it all, I need to give you divine eyes, you know, Chakshuhu Divyam Dadami, that you can, you have to step back. But how does one translate that for us in our conditioned bodies in order to obtain more enjoyment and nothing else?
No one's stopping us from enjoyment. As long as we're enjoying it, that's fine. But that it's not everybody enjoys it, that's what I'm saying. So time may come, oh, I've had enough of enjoyment. Then, and if sometimes, like, you know, it's like a merry-go-round. So you're going out, you know, sometimes enjoying it, and then sometimes you say, my head is spinning, I just want to get out of it. So when somebody says, I want to get out of it, then for some people, that what you say might work. For some people, it may not work. So they have to find, there has to be some many different ways of getting out of it. So as if it works, that's wonderful. And
Swamiji,
it should. I mean, there is no reason why it
shouldn't. Swamiji, would you, with this whole question of reality and so forth, will you encourage people to fight the AIDS in Africa?
Fight?
AIDS in Africa, or to help the victims of the tsunami? In other words, to be actively involved in this reality, then think about another reality which does not relate.
Oh yes, why? Of course, wherever we see suffering, if we are able to help remove it.
But then this world that you say that is suffering, it is not even worth of thinking about.
Well, as if you are going and helping them is real. If the suffering is not real, your helping is not real either. So, so why should you not do it? I mean, you have to do something in this world. And if you are able to help the people in need, in a selfless way, it will help you get out of this. It will help you discover reality. So even as a form of spiritual practice, helping people in need, that's what whole Karma Yoga is about. So what I have said so far gives the impression that we have to neglect human suffering. That's not what's intended at all. In fact, one who neglects human suffering will get more caught up in this. So I think that it's obvious that we have to help.
So that means that we have to face the reality here.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
See, for instance now, in your dream, if you fall down in your dream and your feet start bleeding, you don't say like, it's just a dream, blood, I don't need to go to a doctor. You know, you need to go to a dream doctor to get rid of your dream wound. It's necessary. It has to be done.
Now, there is a logical problem here. You have to first establish that there are two layers of reality, Arif and Parma, and it has to be logically consistently, you know, established. then one thing is behavioric at the empirical level it is true. But when logically we find that it is not satisfactory, we move ahead and go to the higher level of reality. And here we do not find any rupture between the two.
Is it just a comment?
Because if we say that in this empirical world is Maya and all that, this is not the point. In fact, Shankara, every time he begins with the empirical reality one. In fact, 8 months in the whole year, he used to move all around to gather the information. Only 4 months he used to go to Sringeri to collect all the materials about it and synthesize. So empirical reality is there, but logically, there is
a higher thing is, why are you even using the word empirical?
Vyavaharik Satya and Paramarthik Satya is very much there. You can't ignore it.
No. What I am saying is this. You cannot speak about two realities. There is a reality is one. But when you are in the relative plane, you are encountering that reality on the relative plane. So that is your Vyavaharik Satya. So, but when Shankara is in the highest samadhi, Nirkul samadhi, he is not in touch with Vyavaharika reality at all. You cannot be in touch with two realities at the same time. There are in fact no two realities. There is only one reality. But depending on your state of consciousness, you will be in touch with the reality which is in tune with your state of consciousness.
Yes, but what I am trying to say is that logically you have to construct that the higher reality is basically the reality, the Paramarthik Satya.
No, I am not trying to construct. What I am saying is, I am just saying what the Vedas are saying. Again, what we can say is that, how do I know that there is the ultimate reality? I have not experienced it. So how do I know it's there? And that would be a very logical question. And that's where the Vedas begin by saying Shraddha. So first of all, yes, it's not a part of my experience, but if I believe that what is stated in these revealed texts is true, then it would help motivate me to do something to attain that reality. Now, it's fine to begin with faith, but it doesn't have to end in faith. It has to end in direct experience, which the Vedas say it will. So, the question would be, how do I know there is an ultimate reality? And the answer is, well, I just have to have faith. The only difference there is that all my life doesn't have to be spent simply on just saying, oh, just because the books say it's there. What the books also say is that you can experience it directly for yourself. That I can understand. So it's not something that, so the ultimate reality is not something that I'm logically constructing. I'm just saying this is what Vedanta says. And so again, so long as whatever reality we are in, let me just kind of step back a little bit and say this, that whatever all our thinking, willing, dreaming, hoping, everything is done in wherever we find ourselves. And we are where we are. If and when we somehow, the world in which we live and the questions it raises don't seem to satisfy us, it's only then that we say, let me try to find an answer to this question. And then we may probe different philosophies or different fields of study. And then this is one approach, one word with the Vedanta presents, saying, well, if you don't have answers to your question, here is one way of understanding world and reality. Now, it's possible that for some people, this may make sense. For some people say, oh, no, this doesn't make sense, which is fine. Then they can look for some other paradigm which would make sense to them. That's what I'm saying. So I'm not necessarily suggesting something which is like, this is the right way, or this is what everyone should believe. That's not the idea. It's just one word.
There is nothing like Vedanta. You could talk about Advaita Vedanta, Vishishta Advaita, Dvaita Advaita, Shuddha Advaita. There are 10 schools of Vedanta.
I completely disagree with you on that.
That's the problem that I think, actually. If you take up everything as Vedanta, then it creates a problem. You talk about Advaita Vedanta.
Okay, now I would say just the opposite. I think the problem is to see that Advaita Vedanta, Vishishta Advaita Vedanta. I mean, I can understand the academic way of having these, oh, these are the 10 different schools, and I think that has some value in looking at it. But
again,
let me just complete this. I think there is a way, let me put it this way. When we study a subject, there is an academic way of studying it, and there are different ways of studying it. Not everybody studies it as an academic student. So when it's possible when you go to study Vedanta, then you say, well,
how many are the different schools, and which are the different commentators, and that study has a value. Now I'm coming from a very different direction. What I'm saying is, here are the Upanishads, here are the Vedas, whatever it is, and I have to take a study. Now these texts that I study will reveal some meaning to me. Now it's possible that to my particular mind or my particular understanding, it might provide a non-dual understanding, or it could be a qualified non-dualistic, or it could be a dualistic.
Yeah.
So the way I understand it, I could be an Advaitin or a Vishishta Advaitin or a Advaitin or a Keval Advaitin or Shuddha Advaitin, could be any number of school. But what I'm saying is, it's my understanding of what makes sense to me would determine to which school I belong, rather than my going and saying, okay, now I'm saying, this is what Shankara said, this is what Ramanuja said. That's the modern style of education, when you have these different, line up all these different philosophers and say what each one of them says. But the traditional way Vedanta was studied, they really didn't bother. But the teacher under whom I studied in Madras for many years, he used to say, I grew up in a modern education system. So when I used to say, is this Shankara's view? And he would say, no, this is the Veda's view, Vedic view. But he said, this is what Shankara is only in his commentary. He is just saying what he understood of the Vedas. But he would not call it Shankara's philosophy. He would say, this is Vedanta. Now it's possible that Shankara's commentary may not make sense to you, maybe Ramanuja's would, which is fine. So again, I'm not saying you're right or wrong, I'm just saying there is a different way of looking at it. In fact, the teacher under whom I studied Vedanta, he was a very traditional, he had never gone to school or a college. He studied in a Vedic Patshala in South India. And so whenever we would, when we undertook to study a Panchadashi under him about 20 years ago, and one of the first questions I asked him, just like any student would, was, which century was this book written and who wrote it? And he said, why should it matter? He said, if what the book says is true and is in harmony with the Vedic teachings, it could have been written yesterday and it would be equally valuable. Or the book could be utter nonsense and yet be said 10,000 years old. Just because it is very old doesn't make it any more valuable. So that was his approach. And so I kind of belong to that school.
My question is, back to reality. On the topic of reality. So you talked about the reality of the rope. So how do you distinguish between the rope being the rope, me frightened of it because I thought it was a rope, I believed it was a rope, and my consciously imagining the rope, I'm sorry, snake, and me consciously thinking of the rope as a snake. So what is the difference between those three?
Well, you're not thinking of the rope as a snake, you are just seeing a snake.
No, that's the second state. Now I'm introducing the third concept, which is, I look at the rope, I know it is a rope, but I'm consciously imagining, visualizing the rope to be a snake. Does that also come under reality, or does that come under the only subconscious perception is reality?
What do you mean? I mean, if you're looking at the rope and you just say, no, it's a snake. Well, if you succeed in convincing yourself, I mean, how can you look at a rope and convince yourself it's a snake?
No, I'm seeing the rope. So I know it is a rope.
Okay.
I'm not under any delusion there. So I'm seeing
it. Why would you want to see it as a snake? I mean, just for some reason.
That's my question.
My question is, why would you want to see it as a snake?
Half rope, half snake.
No, my question is, how do you distinguish between an imagination? Because my perception of the rope as a snake can be a subconscious imagination of the rope as a snake. I don't know. So that's my question. Is there a distinction at all between imagination being a voluntary, I don't know if it's voluntary, I don't think it's perception.
You're not seeing it, you're just imagining it. But in the example that I gave, you are not imagining the snake, you are actually seeing the snake. Imagining a snake and seeing it is very different things.
So imagination does not come into the spectrum of reality.
No, we are talking about for wrong perception, not wrong imagination.
Okay, with that we will end this session.